Okay, so welcome to the sixth lecture of this course. Before you know starting that, I just want to, because at the end of the fifth lecture, some students asked questions about this polarization phenomena. So I'll explain it little bit in more detail. See, when we actually replaced, you know, when the polarization phenomena was represented by this additional induced positive and negative charges in this circle. Effectively, what we have done is we have basically eliminated that dielectric. In a sense, we don't have to consider that polarization vector and all that. That is all now implicit into these additional positive and negative charges. So again, we don't have to bring in that polarization P vector and all that. Once we have taken their effect into account by this additional positive and negative charges. Now coming to the sixth lecture. So now we'll get into the electrostatics. So now if you actually take a composite dielectric like this of two materials, one and two, and one is oil and other is the press board. Oil's dielectric constant is 2.2, press board is 4.4. So we know the boundary conditions, they can be easily derived from whatever theory we have covered till now. The tangential component is continuous, E1t is equal to E2t. And the normal component is discontinuous by the ratio of the two permittivities in the inverse ratio. That means E1 by E2 is epsilon 2 by epsilon 1. So it is the inverse ratio. So now actually for this configuration, E1 by E2 is E1 n by E2 n because tangential component in this case is 0. Is it not? Tangential component is 0 because we are assuming this as a parallel plate capacitor. And the field lines are all vertical, so there is only normal component, right. So now, so E1 n by E2 n, that is equal to epsilon 2 by epsilon 1, which is nothing but epsilon R 2 by R 1, which is 4.4 by 2 and that is 2. So that means oil gets stressed 2 times under uniform field conditions. So what is this uniform? Because individually if you see, in oil the field is uniform, in this solid insulation the field is uniform. Of course, there is a discontinuity of the field value across the interface, but individually the field is uniform in both the dielectric materials. So oil gets stressed 2 times under the uniform field condition, and that is why we define what is called as utilization factor, which can be defined for this case, which we have seen earlier also. A lead, high voltage lead to ground, and suppose you have oil in between as a dielectric medium, then you will have uniform field would be there when this is replaced by a parallel plate capacitor. That means instead of this lead, if you make a plate here, then it will be uniform field and with the same distance. So with respect to that, here the maximum stress will be at this point, and that will be as compared to the uniform condition with two parallel plates, it will be more, is it not? So that is why the utilization factor is E uniform by E max. That means here the value of the E max is going to be higher, is it not, as compared to E uniform. So you will have this utilization factor which will be always less than 1, is it not? It will be always less than 1. Whereas in some textbooks and some research paper, they talk of enhancement factor, wherein enhancement factor is indicative of how much field is getting enhanced due to non-uniform fields. So then it will be enhancement factor will be 1 over utilization factor. So in this case, the ideal thing is you should have utilization factor close to 1. So utilization factor being close to 1 means what? Everywhere the insulating material is getting uniformly stressed. So material is getting all the regions of the material are getting optimally utilized, is it not? Moment you have utilization factor greater than 1, or sorry, less than 1, or enhancement factor is greater than 1, somewhere the field stress is more, somewhere field stress is less, where the material is same. That means material is not optimally utilized in various regions, is it not? So when we do finite element analysis for insulation design and all that, we basically do some kind of parametric studies to reduce the maximum stress and to make this utilization factor as good as possible. So one option is you can increase the distance, but that will be not economical, is it not? The distance, the clearance will go up, the size will go up. Second is increase the radius of this high voltage lead, right? So that also, that is a good option, and that is generally done if it is possible, if the standard lead sizes are available in bigger radius, and if the space constraint is not there, you can have higher radius. But that also may, because you are going to put more copper, because this lead is a metal. So the the Emax, the question here is when we increase the radius, whether the Emax will increase. What is done is this distance is kept same and the radius will be increased like this. So the clearance will be maintained and the radius will be increased, okay. So the stress will come down here, okay. The third option is one of the best options. Put insulation of higher dielectric constant over the high voltage lead. So what is it, what this is going to achieve? First thing is, because of the theory that we just saw, moment you have a higher dielectric constant material, the electric stress is going to reduce in that. So at the conductor surface inside, the stress is going to go down because now there is a solid insulation of higher dielectric constant. And now inside the oil, the maximum stress is going to be just at the surface of this solid insulation. So there also the stress value is going to go down because you are going little bit away from the high voltage electrode. So the conditions will be little bit better as compared to when it was here. So governing equation for electrostatic is, so starting with divergence, E is equal to rho v upon epsilon, E u replaced by minus del v, and then you get this well known Poisson's equation, del square v is equal to minus rho v upon epsilon. Now here the assumption that we are making is this, it is a uniform homogeneous material. Otherwise, if it is not homogeneous material, heterogeneous material, then this epsilon will come actually inside this del operator, after the del operator, because what is finally del of something is, because there are partial derivatives with respect to x, y, z there. So if dielectric constant is a function of x, y, z, then that dielectric constant should be here, right, and not there. So in the FEM analysis, we will worry about such things more closely. So in this case, if volume charge density rho v is 0, then we go get well known Laplace equation, right. And let us understand little bit on this. So Laplace equation, when expanded, this del square operator in x1, you get this. Now again consider a simple parallel plate capacitor problem. Although it looks very simple, lot of concepts are there even in this to understand. Now the equipotential lines are all horizontal, and E lines, E field lines are all vertical, and they are orthogonal to each other, right. Now here the first question is, when we actually solve this Laplace equation for this, and this of course trivial here, you don't have to really solve anything, this is a trivial solution that lines would be like this. But for the sake of argument, suppose we have to model this and solve in FEM, then we will have to actually solve this Laplace equation. Then we have been always talking about voltage difference, and we are imposing the boundary condition, the voltages are being defined, is it not? But here now you have charges like this, positive and negative charges, and the corresponding voltage is there. So when you actually solve through FEM, you don't actually worry about these charges. The source, finally, what is source? Source in all electromagnetics, there are only sort of two sources, one is charge and other is the current. Actually, really, if you see, the source is only charge, because current is only manifestation of moving charge, is it not? So, but for the sake of discussion, we consider two sources, one is charge and other is current. So here basically this charge distribution is what is giving this potential V. Okay. So now, but when we do FEM analysis, since in finite element method we solve it as a boundary value problem, it's a boundary value problem, we define only after drawing the geometry and doing meshing and all that, we only define the potentials. We don't worry about the charges because charges are implicit in the voltage definition, the boundary condition. Is it clear? So the question asked by one student is, what is this implicitness? So basically this charge distribution is what giving the voltage V. Now these charges have come from where? Some, you know, battery had charged this capacitor and those charges got deposited. Now the charge distribution would be such that it will give the corresponding voltage V, right? Little bit more, you know, when I show you something else, it will be more clear when we consider the end effects. So when, since we are not considering the end effects here, right? So you are getting uniform field and know the, at edges the field is uniform, right? So now before, you know, going to those end effects, we are coming to something called as, you know, boundary conditions. So top plate you are defining voltage V and it is called as non-homogeneous Dirichlet boundary condition. Whenever you specify voltages, right, then it is called as Dirichlet boundary condition. And if the voltage is non-zero, it is called as non-homogeneous. If the voltage is zero, it is called as homogeneous Dirichlet condition. So this terminology you will quite often see in the textbooks on FEM and electromagnetics, okay. So bottom plate is zero. Now two vertical boundaries. Two vertical boundaries, what effectively is happening? We have defined homogeneous Neumann condition. Neumann condition means derivative of field with respect to the distance. Now what is this n? N is the unit normal. That means this is the vertical boundary. The normal to this will be in x direction, is it not? So that is why it is dabba v by dabba n equal to 0. Effectively it is dabba v by dabba x is equal to 0. Is it clear? Now because actually we have defined it as homogeneous Neumann condition and this thing, effectively the field has become uniform, right? If suppose you want to analyze the end effects, what you have to do, we will see in the next you know, slide. So this dabba v by dabba n equal to 0, another point to note is, those who have used FEM and, you know, used solve some electrostatic problem, they will, you know, realize that they never define this dabba v by dabba n equal to 0. They just define this top plate potential and bottom plate potential. These vertical, you know, homogeneous Neumann conditions, that derivatives being equal to 0, are not explicitly defined, right? So that actually get automatically defined during the FEM analysis. How? We will see when we do the FEM understanding of FEM theory. So there I will explain how they get automatically imposed even if you don't actually define them in even commercial softwares, right? Okay. Now the point to be noted here is that we have defined homogeneous Neumann condition here. That means, you know, the field, what does it mean? Dabba V by dabba X is equal to 0 on this vertical boundary. That means what? Here suppose you take this vertical boundary, and this is that dabba V by dabba X is equal to 0. That means voltage at this point and voltage at this point is same. Then only dabba V by dabba X will be equal to 0. Is it not? That means you are making this whole line as equipotential, right? If suppose and this was, you know, this top plate was very close to this, then in fact you know this is a sharp point. So field, the equipotential lines are going to turn like this, is it not, sharply. So in fact dabba V by dabba X is not really going to be 0 at, if you want to consider the end effects. Is this point clear? So by imposing this, you know, not considering the outer boundary and imposing this either implicitly or explicitly, this condition, homogeneous Neumann condition, we have ensured that the field is uniform at the ends. The question asked by one of the students here is, when we don't consider the end effects, what will the potential distribution even above and beyond the plates. So we'll understand that through so this slide here shows a charge density distribution on top and bottom plates of a capacitor, and this is a three-dimensional distribution and with all end effects considered. So you can see at the ends of the, you know, at all the four corners of top and bottom plates, you have sudden and sharp rise in charge density distribution. Positive charge density on the top plate and corresponding negative charge density on the bottom plate. So at the ends of both these plates, four ends, you have sudden increase in electric field intensity because of sharp corners, and therefore those increased values of electric field intensity have to be supported by corresponding charge densities, higher charge densities. So it is very clear from this three-dimensional distribution of charge densities, the corresponding end effects and high rise of electric field intensity and charges in case of a capacitor when end effects are considered. Now the same thing, of course, this I have shown in 2D, right? In the PPT that I showed, it was a three-dimensional distribution, but here on the paper I can show only 2D. So now what I have shown, the charges in the middle, they are sparsely distributed, and charges at the end, they are highly, you know, concentrated because electric field intensity is high. That's what we saw in the previous PowerPoint presentation. So the FEM, so in order to reproduce exactly those high fields and high charges at the ends, you need to have very fine discretization, that is fine FEM mesh at the ends, and you know how to achieve that and all that we'll see when we start looking at FEM, right? So and also remember that when we are actually here, this whole since we want to take the end effects into account, we have enclosed this capacitor configuration into a bigger box. So these are like a bigger rectangle, and in
3D it will be a cuboid,
right? And these distances again from these plates to this box should be sufficiently high so that those boundary conditions do not affect the field distribution, right? So that is one thing. So going further, and also remember the field distribution will not just be like this, but there will be some field lines like this, some field lines like this also. If you actually do the FEM analysis, you will see that, right? So the field is everywhere in this zone, although the field will be much less in this part, but field will still be there because we are not constraining. So we'll take one more this last point and then we'll go to the next topic. So now we will see the conductor dielectric interface, which is very important, and there are some very interesting applications. So first is, if suppose you keep a isolated conductor in electric field, okay. So now this electric field is in this direction, vertical direction upward, and you are keeping the isolated conductor. Now moment you keep it in the E field is everywhere here, the positive charges will get pulled up and negative charges will go down, because again this is positive, this is negative, right? So now the electric field lines will basically be like this, and electric field lines here will terminate on negative charges. So now remember, there is no volume charge here because all the charges got displaced towards the surfaces. So there is no volume charge, there is only surface charge. So that means, in our first Maxwell's equation, divergence D is equal to rho V, there is only volume charge is there. But now since there is no volume charge, the corresponding that equation gets sort of replaced by dN, d normal or epsilon 0 E normal is equal to the corresponding surface charge density. So this is the same, this is the manifestation of that first Maxwell's equation only, written in a different form, because now instead of volume charge, you have surface charge, right? And it makes sense because rho S has the unit of Coulomb per meter square. So that matches with the unit of D, which is also Coulomb per meter square. So that's why D is equal to dn is equal to rho s, right? So the internal E field, now the field also has to be 0 inside this conductor, because there are no charges within the volume of that conductor. If there are no charges in electrostatics, typically when currents are not flowing, if there are no charges, you take any Gaussian surface inside this conductor and calculate integral
E dot ds
is equal to, you know, epsilon integral
E dot ds.
You will get identically 0, because if the charge enclosed is 0, and then you, if you calculate this, E also will be coming to 0, right? And that has to be because there are no charges inside. But charges are, the electric field intensity is only outside the plate. And why electric field is 0, that can be also understood by noting that internal E field gets cancelled, because the internal E field is from positive to negative, is it not? It is vertically down. So that will exactly cancel this external field. So E internal from positive to negative inside the conductor will get, will cancel the E outside. So that actually ensures this condition that E is 0 inside the conductor, because there are no volume charges. So both things are in sync with each other. Now there is one very interesting example of electrostatic shielding and, you know, Faraday cage and all that. So what is that? Let us understand. Now suppose, you know, you have a conducting shell, okay? So maybe you can assume a spherical conducting shell, right? Which is, you know, from inside there is a space inside and there is some charge inside that spherical shell, okay? That is plus Q. Now that plus Q is going to induce negative charges. When I say induce, that means it is going to, you know, pull the negative charges by attraction, right? And this will get negatively charged, this will get positively charged, right? So now if you take any again this conductor, this is a conductor, conducting shell. Now here E is equal to 0 by the same logic that we just now saw. E is 0 here. And that is also can be reconfirmed by taking a Gaussian surface here, and now then the net charge enclosed is 0, is it not? Because this positive Q and negative Q will cancel each other. So the net charge enclosed will be 0 in the Gaussian surface taken inside that, within that conducting shell. Is it clear? So that means, you know, what you have ensured is the E is 0. But then this, you know, when you take a practical application, you cannot have these positive charges remaining there. You have to drain them to ground, because otherwise, the, if you put it like this, this outer, you know, conductor potential will be corresponding to this V, these charges, and that can be quite high depending upon what is this plus Q here and the corresponding voltage. So that's why you need to ground this outer one, and then it becomes a perfect shielding. Right, and that is the principle behind this electrostatic shielding, that, you know, we have a Faraday cage metallic enclosure and there is a high voltage source inside, right? And then we ground that Faraday cage, and then what happens is the same thing, only thing now it is a cube here, this conducting shell is cube here with some finite, you know, metal thickness. And now if we ground this, this all these positive charges will go to ground, and inside this thin, you know, metallic box with a metal thickness, the E is going to be 0 there, because of the same phenomena, plus Q, this is say plus Q, there will be minus Q on the inside of this metallic enclosure. And if you now take any Gaussian surface within the thickness of that Faraday cage, the total charge enclosed will be 0, and that is why E everywhere will be 0 inside that. So effectively what you have done, you have actually, since E is 0 inside that metallic plate like here, you have effectively isolated the inside and outside environments, because there is, you know, no E field. So there is some region which is separating inside and outside wherein E is 0. That means there will not be any, you know, effects of outside voltage as well as inside voltage on vice versa. Is this point clear? So that is the principle behind this electrostatic shielding. So I'll just repeat what we just now said about this electrostatic shielding. You have, you know, some high voltage, there could be some high voltage source which represents this positive charge Q, and around it you have this conducting shell, and then you have this minus charges induced as shown on the inner surface of the shell and plus charges on the outer surface of the shell. And since these charges, positive end charges, got separated and there is no you know, charge inside this conducting shell, E is 0, right? And then that is how these two surfaces, they got sort of electrically isolated, you can say, because E is 0 now. Now this again interesting thing to, you know, understand what I just said, that these become electrically isolated. We'll just extend this case. Suppose this is that plus Q charge and you have this minus charges induced in this conducting shell, and you have this corresponding plus charges on the outside. Now suppose actually we, what we do is we this plus Q charge we shift. Now it is shown concentric here or symmetric. If I shift this Q charge on this side, right hand side, what will happen? These negative charges on this side will be more, is it not? And negative charge, you know, the density on this side will be less. But what will happen on these positive charges? They will remain as they are, right? Because now there is no sort of connection between this positive charges and these negative charges, because they are sort of, because E is 0 in between, right? But if I suppose, you know, bring one ground plate in the vicinity of this now set of electrodes, now what is going to happen? These positive charges will get concentrated on this side, right? So when we actually have had initially drawn this figure, we assume that there are no, you know, other objects, charge objects in the vicinity, and this whole system is electrically isolated, right? And then that's why then these positive charges become, you know, they are sort of independent of movement of this high voltage source or plus Q source within this innermost, you know, part, right? Okay, if we have understood this, then as I mentioned in the previous slides, after, you know, putting this conducting shell, we should ground it so that these positive charges will get drained to ground, and then, you know, this will be safe electrically even to touch, right? So I will show you one interesting application and practical, you know, demonstration of this. So in this slide, what you see is a high voltage source. This is a high voltage transformer, which, you know, for which 230 volts is the input and 100 kV is the output at this point. Now you can see all these, you know, electrodes which are having high voltage, they are, you know, smooth electrodes, rounded electrodes, because otherwise they will lead to high voltage stresses and would they themselves become source of corona or partial discharge, right? So all these high voltage equipment, this is 100 kV source, is enclosed in this aluminum cage, right? And if you are able to notice this, can you see this? There is a copper strip running all over, is a, you know, copper strip here, which runs at the bottom level of this Faraday cage from inside. And this basically copper strip positively connects all these individual panels of this aluminum cage, and this cage is grounded to an earth pit, right? High voltage source is inside this cage, and this is a, you know, mesh here to see what is happening inside. So this cage is grounded through an earthing pit. So this becomes an electrostatic case of electrostatic shielding, And here, you know, the thickness of this aluminum cage is really not so much important for the point of view of electrostatic shielding, right? Whatever thickness mechanically, you know, sufficient and commercially available, you can use that. But later on, we will see when we are interested in electromagnetic shielding. So what we just saw is electrostatic shielding from the point of view of high voltage. But suppose you are conducting some test inside this setup, which generates high frequency EM waves, electromagnetic waves, like for example, corona or partial discharge studies. Those frequencies you want to shield from going out and affecting some electronic products, as well as if there are some discharges happening outside, those discharges should not affect the tests that are being conducted inside. So either ways you want electromagnetic shielding. Now this is, you know, high frequency shielding. So for that, later on when we study the theory of eddy currents, we will see that you need to have finite thickness of this shield depending upon the frequency of interest. So that we'll study later. So what we just saw was only the electrostatic shielding. The electromagnetic shielding we'll discuss little bit later.
Before ending discussion on electrostatics, let us discuss one practical example of condenser bushings in which capacitive grading is done to improve E-field distribution. We know for a coaxial cable configuration as shown here with two cylindrical electrodes, the E-field is non-uniform as given by this curve. The electric field intensity is high at the conductor surface here, inner conductor, and as we go away from there in this insulation here near the outer electrode is less stressed. The E field intensity is less here, and in that sense this insulation is not effectively utilized. Stress is higher here, stress is lower here, and that is not a good insulation design. So E max is given by this formula. So E max will be at this point, and it is given by this formula. Now how do we make this electric field intensity more or less uniform? We cannot make it absolutely uniform, but how do we make it close to uniform distribution? So there are different ways in which one can achieve this. One of the common ways we will discuss in the next slide. So let us understand in this slide how capacitive grading in condenser bushings achieves more or less uniform E-field distribution. Now what are condenser bushings? They basically connect transformer high voltage terminals to transmission lines. A condenser bushing consists of central HV conductor, right, which on one side it connects to transformer winding. On the other side, it connects to transmission line. So what is done here is you have this HV conductor of condenser bushing. That conductor is taken out of transformer tank through this opening, and these are the metal flanges here which are at ground potential. So this HV conductor has to be properly insulated from this ground. If we put simply, you know, paper insulation here throughout, then it will be non-uniformly stressed as explained in the previous slide. So what is done is we insert here electrically floating cylindrical conductors, and they basically get potentials on them based on their position here. And in between these foils, of course, there is paper insulation. Now this figure, this actual configuration, can be equivalently represented by this schematic. Now this is not to the scale, right? And you know, central conductor is assumed to be at some positive potential at the instant being considered. So there will be some positive charge on that conductor, central conductor. So now these floating metallic coils will basically, they will get charged to negative and positive values as shown, and that too alternately. So here you will have negative charge on this side, on this surface you'll have positive charge, again negative and positive charge on the next cylindrical foil conductor, and so on. So thing to note here is this total charge on this, for example negative charge here on this surface, will be numerically equal to this positive charge. Of course this positive charge will be again equal to this negative charge in terms of magnitude. So now this, if we have understood this charge distribution, so let us then go further and understand how uniform E field distribution is achieved. So in 2D cross section, these floating metallic cylindrical foil, they basically will appear as line charges, and for line charges E max is given by this standard formula Q upon 2 pi epsilon Rn ln, where Rn is mean radius and ln is length of the nth metal foil, right? So let us derive this formula from fundamentals. If you consider insulation between any two conductors, for example let us take this central conductor and this first metal conductor, this floating which is at floating for some floating potential, rho s will be given by d max, and this d max will be normal to the conductor, so in the horizontal direction. And what is rho s? Rho s is the surface charge, as we saw in the previous slide. So rho s is d max, and d max is epsilon e max. And what is e max? E max is v upon a ln v by a, as seen on the fifth slide, right? So going further, rho s can also be written as q upon surface area. So what is surface area? 2 pi r into l, because 2 pi r is circumferential length, into l, which is length or height of the conductor. So rho s is given by this, which is nothing but d max, and d max is equal to epsilon e max. So from this we get e max as this, which is same as this formula. Now if you replace q by ln, q upon ln by rho, which is charge per unit length in coulomb per meter, then we get this formula, which was given in fact in lecture 4, slide 4. So now coming back to how do we get improved E field distribution. In this formula, if we maintain E max constant in each of these capacitors, now these are capacitors, these are all capacitors. So in each of these capacitors, if we maintain E max constant, and how do we do that? We just keep this R L product constant. Q is anyway same for all these conductors, as was explained on the previous slide. So as mean radius is going up as you go away from the central conductor, what you do is you reduce the height or length of these floating metallic conductors, and by virtue of that you can maintain E max as constant, and because of that the uniform, more or less uniform E field distribution is obtained. Now let us understand this more intuitively. When we are reducing this height of these layers, what actually we are doing is we are reducing the effective capacitance between these conductors. Why? Because surface area is reducing. Because epsilon A by D is a standard capacitance formula for a parallel plate capacitor, of course. So if A reduces, D being constant, the capacitance is reduced, but charge is same, so V will increase. So V will increase. Now this is fixed potential. Potential of this conductor is increasing, thereby it reduces the electric field intensity between these two conductors, right? So this is how Emax comes down, and then you know it can be maintained. Emax can be maintained constant by keeping this product as constant. It should be remembered that here we have done some approximations. For example, we have neglected fringing at the ends. If we have to consider fringing, then of course we need to do finite element analysis. And then how do we do that for our typical high voltage insulation system? We will do that kind of understanding in one of the lectures later.
So with this we conclude this lecture 6, and we have finished electrostatics part of our course, and we will in the next lecture we'll start with magnetic fields. Thank you.